Welcome on board our 40-day journey, a new life. We're reading this book, Purpose-Driven Life, and it's What on Earth Am I Here For? By Rick Warren. Welcome on board. So today is day 18, and as usual, thank you so much to everyone who's been part of this. I know ideally sometimes we need to let you know ahead of time when we're coming so you'll be a lot more prepared, but most times for us things just happen and we just go with the flow. So today's day 18 and we're gonna carry on reading our book, trying to inspire ourselves, trying to motivate ourselves, trying to see how we can make sense of this life that we find so complicated. Yes, life is really complicated. And sometimes we see some of us get so lost and so confused that we need help. We need extra help. And that's when books like that come into use. And books like the Bible absolutely come into use. I had one of those scenarios where things had definitely gotten so heavy on me and I was lost. And in the process of getting lost, I realized I needed help. But you see, when we talk about help, it's not until you run to your friends and say, give me help, or run to your mom, or run to your sister, or best friend, or husband, or wife. There are times you can help yourself. And how do you do that? There are loads of books all written out to, you know, to give you hope, to inspire you, to motivate you. And this is one of those books. And that's why when I decided to take this on, a voice came to me, you know, there are lots of people out there struggling with issues. It would be nice if you share this experience with them. And that's why I decided to video this. But then we realized that it's such a huge commitment because it's 40 days program. And today is only day 18. That we promised ourselves to do this. And that's why we have to keep going until we finish it. And the whole idea, what we call it, a new life, is by the time we're done, that state of mind, which is what life is all about, it starts from the mind. Our state of mind will be renewed. Our state of mind will be different. Our state of mind will be, we see some glimmer of hope at the end of this tunnel. And that's the whole dream behind taking on this project. So let's dive into it. This is Easter week, so we hope you are having a great time enjoying your Easter, that time when Jesus died on the cross for us, which was yesterday, Friday, and then tomorrow he's going to resurrect. So this is really exciting for us Christians because that shows that whatever it is that we're going through, the darkest times of our lives, that there is hope because Jesus resurrected and then he defeated death. That means no matter how dark your scenario may be, there is hope and you can overcome because Jesus already did it on the cross for us and so he died for all of us. To try and, you know, stop us from achieving our purpose in this earth. Just take hope on that and it will help make you stronger and ready to carry on. So we're going to get on with it. So chapter 18 is titled Experiencing Life Together. So experiencing life together, each one of you is part of the body of Christ and you were to live together in peace. So he says each one of us, we are the part of the body of Christ. So this is mostly again picking on us Christians. We are meant to live together in peace. And this is Colossians chapter 3 verse 15. And the next quotation says, how wonderful it is, how pleasant for God's people to live together in harmony. So that's another great, you know, quotation he's given us. And that's Psalm 133, verse 1. It's wonderful that we live together in peace and in harmony. So life is meant to be shared. That's what this chapter is telling us. Life is meant to be shared. And God intends for us to experience life together. So as a people, God wants us to have life together. The Bible calls this shared experience fellowship. So today the word has lost most of its biblical meaning. This fellowship word has lost its meaning. So fellowship to them, to people who get it all mixed up, say, means casual conversation, sometimes socializing, sometimes food and fun. So when you go to church, you say, oh, yeah, we're going to have fellowship. Most people get it all mixed up. And we're thinking it's all about casual chit-chat. Let's just go have some drinks and have some food, and that's fellowship. Says no. Question he's asking us, where do you fellowship? And what does it mean? Where do you attend church? And you stay after for fellowship. And most times we think when we stay after in church for fellowship, we think it means we should wait for refreshment. So we think that's what fellowship means. But real fellowship is so much more than just showing up at services. It means more than going to church. So we're saying tomorrow is Easter. You see most of us, like my local church, that's when you see the church packed full. Everybody comes on Easter Day. But it says it is more than that. It's more than just showing up at the church service. It says it is experiencing life together. That's what fellowship is all about. It's experiencing life together as a group of people. It includes unselfish loving, honest sharing, practical serving, sacrificial giving, sympathetic comforting, and all the other ones, one another. Commands found in the New Testament. So whenever the commands are talking about one another, that's referring to fellowship. So when it comes to fellowship, size matters. The smaller the size, the better. That's what he's trying to explain fellowship to us now. So we can't worship with a crowd. So like Easter Sunday now, there's a huge crowd in church. We can worship together, but we fellowship with a few people. So only a few people can come together and fellowship. He said, the membership should not be more than 10 as participation starts to fade and some members start to dominate. So when we are fellowshipping together, it shouldn't be a huge crowd, because the minute it becomes a huge crowd, some people may want to dominate this crowd and some people may lose interest in what's going on. So a smaller size makes a big difference with fellowshipping. So Jesus ministered in small groups of disciples. And for Jesus, he had 12 disciples. And that's how he preferred his ministry. So when he wants to chat with them on a one-to-one, he preferred smaller crowds. 12 was his maximum. And Christians need to be involved in a small group within their churches. So just going to church is not enough. That does not encourage fellowship. That's worshiping. We can all sit there and sing and, you know, be happy, be in service. But the minute you want to fellowship, which is interacting with each other, we need a smaller group so that a few people don't come and dominate it. You say, home fellowship groups, a Sunday school class, or a Bible study group. This is where real community takes place, not in the big gatherings, not in this huge service that comes on Sunday. In the last chapter, we talked about church membership and not being spectators. So in church, the last chapter, we talked about it. Some people just come to church to become spectators, and some people come to become members. So now we're going after the membership stage. What's the next stage? That's the fellowship stage. So God has made an incredible promise about a small group of believers. And what did he say? He said, for where two or three have gathered together in my name, I am there in their midst. So in the Bible, it's clearly written, God wants us to fellowship together. And he said, for as long as two or three people are together, calling on his name, he is there. And that's fellowship. So however, even being in a small group does not guarantee experience of real community, though. He's explaining that. So many classes are stuck in superficiality. So many of us will create little groups and think that we're fellowshipping. He says, because sometimes this group are stuck in superficiality and have no clue as to what it's like to experience genuine fellowship. So what is the difference between real fellowship and fake fellowship? She's going to explain this to us now. In real fellowship, people experience authenticity. Authenticity is all about being genuine. being honest, given heart-to-heart relationship, sometimes gut-level sharing. So if you're feeling something, and you know, when we say gut, we're talking about our stomach. So if you're feeling something in your gut, and you've heard when people refer to a definite, you know, defined feeling, they go, I feel it deep in my gut. And that's when you know that this is real. So he says, real fellowship, you can share your gut feeling. Whatever's deep in your heart, you can open up with this small crowd and tell them what you're feeling. That's what real fellowship is. And you're gonna, you know, the chapter gets even more and more interesting because it starts to explain to us how we all need each other. And I think sharing this book with you is another form of fellowship as well, which is why I keep saying to you, whatever you're feeling, share it with me. Tell me. Let's understand what your experience is happening or what's happening to you as we are reading this book and sharing it together. Whatever you are experiencing as the book's opening up itself to you, feel free, let's chat about it. Because there's so much out there that people are bottling up. And these fellowship groups allow you to open up and speak what you're feeling and be honest and genuine and be authentic and share your gut feeling, something coming from deep in your heart. And you notice sometimes I always say, let me share with you my experiences or some of the lessons I've taken from the chapters. I mean, further down, I'll share what I felt from the last chapter. But this is an opportunity for all of us to share with each other. So in real fellowship, this is what happens. Authenticity happens. And it is genuine, and it is heart-to-heart, and sometimes gut-level sharing. It happens when people get honest about who they are and what is happening in their lives. And you're going to find out that we actually absolutely do need each other. We just lost somebody in the family, and this has been a really, really difficult time for every member of the family. And what tends to happen is we all react differently to difficult times. And so if we have this really small group where we can open up to each other, you then share how you feel about this scenario with the other person. That's what fellowship is all about. So two or three together sharing what they're feeling, that's fellowship. And then what the Bible is saying, or the book is even reminding us, is it shouldn't be more than 10. But Jesus did 12. So we can break down our fellowship to as small as 3, and we can go as high as 12. But the smaller the number, the better, because then you can really open up with each other and share how you feel about this thing going on. So they share their heart. We just talked about bereavement. So how you are feeling about what has happened, you share that heart with each other. You reveal your feelings to this other person. You confess your failures. So whatever you were thinking of doing and it's not happening, you confess it. You say, you know what? I tried this, but it didn't work. This is how I feel about it. You disclose your doubts. I did try something, or I was going to try something, and I don't know if it's going to work or not. So when you do that, your fellowship member may be in a position to support you, and he's going to explain all of this. You admit your fears. I was going to try something, but I'm afraid. This is how I'm feeling about it. You acknowledge your weakness. Then you ask for prayer and you ask for help. Now that's a big thing that's come out of this book. And when I read this, I felt so good about it. Because you're going to even hear more. You say authenticity is the opposite of what we find in some churches. Very true. You go to church, you're genuinely hoping to meet people who are honest and sincere and want to relate to you. And then all you're meeting is people who are extremely fake. We're going to come to that. So he says, instead of an atmosphere of honesty and humility, there is pretending, role-playing, politicking, superficial politeness, and shallow conversation. And this is in church. So if this is happening in church, at what stage do you meet real, genuine people who are authentic, who go through all the things we've just explained, disclose their doubts and admit their fears and acknowledge their weaknesses? Because the people we're actually seeing there now are pretentious role-playing people who are politicking in church and superficial and lack, you know, they bring superficial politeness and shallow conversation that has nothing to do with their guts. It's just coming from the mouth. So people wear masks. You say people wear masks in these gatherings. They keep their guard up. So they're constantly guarded because they don't know what they're going to say that will trigger something or hurt someone or may not be right. They act as if everything is rosy in their life. So people like this exist. So many of us exist like that. And I found this really amazing coming from a book. And this is why most times I remind people, I say, in a book is hidden gems. Because things that you imagine may be real, they are real when you actually read a book. They hide the truths in books. Look at this amount of truth in a book. It says, I felt it was really, really awesome. Especially, and this is me talking, especially to us black people. We have, because I've taken my time to try and understand us. Hence, you know, I keep telling you about that book I have as well, Man's Search for Meaning. I'm constantly asking questions. In my training, when students come here, they go, you're the one person I know that just tells things as it is. And because that's just who I am, I tell you how it is. I have lived here for nearly 23 years now, or 24. And I have walked across the spectrum. I've walked in the highest area, and I work with children, and I work with adults, and I work with all races. From the moment you meet other races, especially the white race, these people are as open as a book. They will tell you every feeling they have. And I work with clients here as well, and I tell you, I know all my clients. From the minute they walk in and sit on my chair, we start chatting. And they tell you everything they're experiencing. What this does to people is it frees their mind. People are free because they're opening up to you and it's come out. And you know that saying that a problem shared is a problem halved. Because the minute you bring it out, the person trusts what they feel about it. You suddenly feel a lot more lighter. When I come across our own people, this is when the book closes. This is when the book closes. And you know what the man is saying here? He says, people wear masks. They keep their guard up and they act as if everything is rosy in their lives. So this is what you find with us, especially us black people. We behave as if we are perfect. They never tell you anything, and they carry the pain of their problems in their heart. And this is so shocking, because now what we've realized, I trained one of the students who works in a mental home, one of the biggest mental hospital in the UK, I think Broadmoor is called. And this guy came to learn from us. Why? Because he needed to be tightening the locks of the inmates and braiding their hair and all kinds of things. And he's a white man. So I was like, why do you have to learn how to tighten locks and braids? Oh, because the inmates there are mostly black and they need their hair done. But obviously because they are mental, we can't let them go out and get their hair done. And we can't let people come in to do their hair because security reasons. So he had to come out and train. That just goes to explain to you what is going on. Because if you hold all your problems inside, what it does, it mentally affects you. You then hear depression. You then hear stress. You then hear all kinds of things going on. Now, reading a book like this that we've been reading, it just opens up to tell us that whatever problem we are going, you know, we're experiencing, ours is not the worst. That's just the way it is. Because from some, I think chapter 5, we've been made to understand that this is not our final destination. We're just passing through. And one of the reasons this happens is because we're not meant to be comfortable here. And that's why we've learned that no matter what happens, there is always something that doesn't sit right. So you might think, oh yeah, because, you know, if only I have money. You find that people who have money are still sad. You go, if only I went to school. You find that people who have all the education in the world are still upset and sad. If only I was taller. Tall people are complaining if only they were shorter. If only I'm prettier. Pretty people are complaining if only I had a regular look. So there is nothing you have that covers everything. And so when you go through difficult times, I remember the last chapter or the chapter before, Jesus carried the cross for us. He went through beatings. People were spitting at him. People were jeering at him. He had done no wrong. And he did all of that for our sake. So that when we pray to God and say, through Jesus Christ the Lord, God have mercy on us. So, for as long as that happened, there is no one of us on this earth that's going to flow through without a problem. I don't know any one person who can stand up and say, I have no problem on this earth. And so, whatever you're going through, it is best you interact with people, like-minded people, who can relate to you. That's what we're referring to here as fellowship. Fellowship people who are genuine people, who are honest people, you can share your fears with, your sadness with, your happiness with, so that they, you can all be happy together. The sooner you open up and share what you're experiencing in life with other people, the better your life will be. That's the big message here. That's why he's reminding us that we should have fellowship. And I'm thinking, fellowship does not necessarily mean until you go to church. A group of people that you can relate to, that you can open up to, that you're not afraid of sharing your deepest heart with. And you know me by now, if you're a user of our channel, you know me. Because whenever I am under any type of pressure, whichever, whatever it is, I come here and I open up and I chat with you. And this has endeared me to so many people because now they understand that I'm as genuine as they see me. I don't hold up to anything. Anybody who sits out there and tells you their life is perfect, they are lying. And we all know that. Because then it comes out in another form. They lose it in another form. So the big message here is open up. Fellowship with people. And, you know, again, why some people are so scared is they think people are going to judge them. So they don't want to share anything about themselves with other people. But you know, when I come here and I tell you things about myself, whatever you read out of it is up to you, is no longer my problem. I tell you because when I tell you a problem shared is a problem halved, I feel I've let it out and the stress goes with it. So rather, this is time to change all these habits. That's what he's saying. It is time we change it. These attitudes are the death of real fellowship. So when you carry on with this, I am perfect, this shallowness, this role playing, this pretending, when you do that, you kill fellowship. You kill relationship. In the news today, which was something I saw recently, and they were just talking about, here in the UK, there's a charity called NSPCC, NSPCC, and thereafter, they look after children. And the news had it that children as young as 6 years old are calling to complain about loneliness. Now, when you hear things like that, it really touches as a mother. I have children and I understand. How could a six-year-old child be lonely? Because we live in a time when nobody cares about the other person. And they were interviewing these young people And they were thinking, could it be social media that's causing the problem? Because obviously, you know, we have all this Instagram, we have Facebook, we have Snapchat, and the way people look at them as success is you have 50,000 subscribers or followers, you have 1 million followers. And to a young person, that's love. They think, yeah, people love me. And you know what young people do? They spend money. They will take wherever they can find this money just to fit into a role. And they buy things they don't need just so that they will be liked. And then when you get liked like that on the social media, reality is different. So when they were interviewing them, they said, you know, when things are really tough with them, the chips are down. Nobody talks to them. Suddenly, they don't know who to call. But they have 50,000 likes on Instagram. They have 1 million followers on Facebook. The question was, is this social media causing this problem? I don't know. But it's time we honestly, genuinely care about each other. So it's only as we become open about our lives that we experience real fellowship. And the Bible says, if we look in the light as God is in the light, we can share fellowship with each other. So looking in the light is looking at God. If we say we have no sin, we are fooling ourselves. So anybody that's sitting out there and acting this pretentious life that my life is perfect, nothing is ever wrong with it, the message here is you're fooling yourself. Because we all do have issues. For clear reason, that's just the way it was made to be. Now, there is need for fellowship. Because when you fellowship, when you have relationship, when you have real friends, genuine people, you can share whatever you're experiencing with them. This is so true. Everyone experiences problems. Because life itself is a test. We read that before. So we are constantly tested with problems to strengthen us and to make us grow up to maturity. Once we understand that problems are here to challenge us to be strong, then we can face up to problems. We can deal with it when it comes because we know it is meant to be there. This is why I do this program, and it's naturally nothing to be ashamed of. Whatever issues you're going through, it's not for you to crawl under the chair and take the covers and cover your head and say, mine is the worst. If I tell anybody, it's the worst thing ever. People are going to laugh at me. People are going to make jokes of me. So I'm not going to tell anybody. Let me just swallow it and deal with it myself. He says, when you do that, you're fooling yourself. Because you're meant to open up and let people hear what you're going through. And then you get that support. The world thinks intimacy occurs in the dark. But God says it happens in the light. That's a big message. God says intimacy happens in the light. Darkness is used to hide our hurts, faults, fears, failures, and flaws. God says we should take it away from darkness. So if we're hurting, we should let people know. If we're afraid, we should let people know. If we have failed, we should share with people. If we have flaws, we should let somebody know about it. Because when you do that, you allow the light to shine in. Because what you then find most times, especially with young people, they end up going taking drugs. They end up becoming alcoholics. And then what happens when you do that? You start to destroy yourself even more. And you find, especially here in the UK, in London in particular, you get young people marching around town with knives, ready to stab the other friend. For the least provocation, they are already ready to stab and kill another person. But why? Because they don't share what they are experiencing. You know, most times, maybe they are unemployed. Maybe there's no money coming in. And suddenly they feel so angry deep inside. And the least thing somebody says to them, provocation comes in. If you share your issues, if you let people know, they might guide you. They might tell you where to get help. They must support you. That's what fellowship is all about. So we bring our problems to the light, all out into the open, and admit who we really are. We should really let people know who we really are. There is no point hiding in the dark. Because when you hide your flaws, all you're doing is you're creating more problems for yourself. So of course, being authentic requires both courage and humility. So people who actually come out and share their issues with you, it takes a lot of courage. Because now you're scared, you don't know what people are going to say. Remember we talked about being judgmental. People are going to sit back and judge you. But when you're honest enough with yourself and you become humble and come to people and say, please, this is what I'm experiencing, things start to change. It means facing our fears of exposure, of rejection, of judgment and being hurt again. So this is usually the reasons people hide themselves. Because they're thinking, people are going to judge me. People are going to reject me. Oh, who's going to make friends with that one? Look at what she just went through. Oh, look at her. Why did she put herself in that situation? Whatever it is. Oh, she's been exposed. Wow. He said no. And then most times you feel you're going to be hurt twice. No, real fellowship does not bring things like that to people. Again, as usual, we always say to you, share with us what you're feeling. If anything we're talking about is making sense to you, we like to hear your thoughts about it. He said, why would anyone take such risk of being honest and genuine with other people? Because it's the only way to grow spiritually and be emotionally healthy. And when I heard this one, I was really, really touched and I was really, really happy. Because I am just naturally like that. I'm naturally sharing my feelings with people. And I had no idea that I was actually growing emotionally strong and healthy and spiritually strong. Maybe emotionally strong, yes. Because you know what, my attitude, a problem halved is a, you know, a problem shared is a problem halved. But I never really understood that it helps your spirit as well because it lightens you. So there's no heaviness in your heart. So this is the reason you have to learn to open up and share everything you're dealing with people around you. Real fellowship. Bible says, make this your common practice. Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so you can live together whole and healed. So when you open up, you're confessing, you're letting it out. You live together whole and healed. It's one of my biggest issues. Seriously, it's one of the biggest things I struggle with. If I'm interacting with anybody and they don't tell me as they feel or their genuine innermost thoughts or who they really are and I get to find out, you've lost me. Because I don't like dealing with people who keep things inside. And I'm telling you, it does not matter who you are to me. The minute I find out that you're just deliberately holding yourself away, then you've lost me. Because I can't relate to you. I'm naturally ready to share whatever it is. Friends, family, whoever. So, learn this. Bible's telling us here. And this man is telling, it says, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so you can live together, whole and healed. We only grow by taking risk. We only grow by taking risk. And the most difficult risk of all is to be honest with ourselves. Now, when you read things like this, it really, really touches you. The most difficult risk we can ever take in our life is to be honest with ourselves and be honest with each other, especially people you have taken to heart to say, this will mean something to you. This is what I have practiced all my life, sharing my life with you as my friends, to let you know that we all have experiences of hurt and pain too. So when I open up here and I tell you things, it's just to remind you. It's just a testimony of what we are thinking. To tell you that nobody's life is perfect. And so I might sit here sometimes looking all glossy and glamorous and beautiful. Deep in me, whatever is going on, I share it. I share it because the minute I do that, I know I've let it go. It's gone. I'm free. My heart is light. And the whole idea is for you to understand that whatever you are going through, you are not alone. Everybody goes through things. So number two, he says, in real fellowship, people experience mutuality. Mutuality means, this is happening to me, that is happening to you. Mutuality is the art of giving and receiving. You give and you take. So if you've told me what you are experiencing, and I've listened and I've heard and I've supported you, when things happen to me, I can come to you and say, look at what's happening to me as well. So we're mutually sharing. It's depending on each other. The Bible says the way God designed our bodies is a model for understanding our lives together as a church. Every part dependent on every other part. So it's a bit like our body as well. He explained that in the last chapter. He says the hand, the leg, whatever parts of our body all connects to create a big whole. And the same thing with the church. So individuals that are members of that church, that's how you're connected to create a big whole. So relationships, each member of this relationship or this fellowship come together to create a big whole. So if the whole idea is that each member participates, and then your part is to just sit back and watch, you're not helping that organization or that body to grow. So all of us are more consistent in our faith when others walk with us and encourage us. So we help each other when we encourage each other. The Bible commands mutual accountability, mutual encouragement, mutual serving, and mutual honoring. Over 50 times in the New Testament, we are commanded to do different tasks to one another. So in the Bible, New Testament says, do things for one another. That's God's way of reminding us that we do need each other. We all need each other. And I don't know if it was last chapter I mentioned that. The other day I went out to the beach and I was just walking around and I was standing really high up. And I could see across the beach. And it just clicked in my head. You know, we say we're running a business, but we cannot run a business without other people. So if people are not buying from you, what business are you running? That's a big question. So that's how we all need each other no matter what we do. I mean, you hear of great companies doing amazing things. You know, Apple. And you see how much money they declare each year. Whatever this business is, if people are not buying from them, that business does not exist. It cannot grow. So as humans, we all need each other. You give them something, they give you something back. It's like the business I run here, helping people to gain skills, which I always show you our home training pack. Again, we created this because people said to us they couldn't travel down here because most of our clients are really far away from where we are, mostly the US, Canada, Australia. And so we realized that we needed to put something together to help. And we created that. So if we've created that and you need skills, that's your answer. But when you respond by buying this to gain skills, you give me something, which is the price of the program. So you see how we all need each other. That's mutuality. You give, I receive, and you receive as well. Because you get in the training, the skill in your hand, you have got something. When you have that skill, you also share it with your clients, they give you something, and you give them something. That's just the way life is. It's about give and take. You cannot exist in this world in isolation. Nobody does. And I think the last chapter mentioned that as well. You cannot be strong in Christianity when you're existing just by yourself. The question was, so who is challenging you? Because the only time you know you need to be strong is when you deal with scenarios that are not what you expected. And wherever the fellowship is, wherever there's a crowd of people, you're going to come and meet people who are not agreeing with you. That's where the challenge comes in. And when you can overcome that, that's when you realize that you're strong. And so isolation is not what God created. He never created isolation. He's always wanted us to blend together. And so that's why he explained here. The over 50 times in the New Testament, God commanded that we do different tasks to one another. Bible says, make every effort to do what leads to peace and to mutual edification. You are not responsible for everyone in the body of Christ, but you are responsible to them. So number three says, in real fellowship, people experience sympathy. In real fellowship, people experience sympathy. And so sympathy is not about giving advice or offering quick cosmetic help. That's not sympathy. Sympathy is entering in and sharing the pain of others. So somebody's just gone through a very difficult time, like we talked about the bereavement we're having in our family, and you can relate to it. You're trying to, you know, enter in and share this pain. You feel lost. That's what sympathy is. So this person is experiencing something that's really, really beyond your control. You flow into that experience and you feel it. That's sympathy. Sympathy says, I understand what you're going through, and what you feel is not crazy nor strange. So you find some people, when you want to experience something with them or share an experience with them, they actually stand aloof and just staring at you like, is she all right? She sounds crazy to me. Because you're being judgmental. But sympathy is about, wow, that's happening? Really? How are you feeling? You know, you really get into their state. That's sympathy. Some people call it empathy. And I remember, you know, it got to a state somehow, people were like, don't say you can sympathize, say you can empathize. It's a matter of dictionary and definition. But relating to that scenario, that's what this is all about. The Bible calls it sympathy, although we now choose. Today's dictionary says empathy. The Bible says, as holy people, we have to be sympathetic and kind and humble and gentle and patient. So when we're relating to other people, these are the things God expects us to do. Sympathy meets two fundamental human needs: the need to be understood and the need to have your feelings validated. Every time you understand and affirm, you are being sympathetic. Every time we understand and affirm someone's feelings, we build fellowship. So whenever you can relate to somebody's experience, you're building a fellowship with that person. The problem is that we are often in so much of a hurry to fix things that we don't have time to sympathize with people. Now it's beginning to break it down, what's happening to us, why fellowship is disappearing. Because when you relate to people in their experiences, you have created fellowship. But suddenly the reality of our times now is, we do not relate to people at all. We are in so much of a hurry. And because we're in a hurry, we're not creating fellowship anymore. Or we are too preoccupied with our own hurts. So most times when people want to share their experiences of pain and hurt and sadness or whatever with you, you're so busy being hurt yourself with your own pain, you don't want to hear them out. Dries up sympathy of others. So because you are in your state of pain, you don't want to hear the other person's experience. There are different levels of fellowship. And so he breaks down fellowship when you're able to share with people now. Fellowship of sharing, that's the first one. So you're sharing experiences. Then there's fellowship of studying in God's word together. So fellowship of serving is another one. When we minister together on mission trips or mercy trip. And then there's also fellowship of suffering, where we enter into each other's pains and griefs and carry each other's burdens. The Christians who understand this level best are those around the world who are being persecuted, despised, and often martyred for their faith. So this is going deeper into Christianity. the fellowship of suffering. The Bible commands us, share each other's troubles and problems, and this way, obey the law of Christ. So when we share each other's pains, we're obeying the law of Christ. It is the times of deep crisis, grief and doubt that we need each other most. So most times, is when things have gone completely crazy in our lives that we need each other most. And that's what we need to really understand. That fellowship is very important in our lives. When circumstances crush us to the point that our faith falters, that's when we need believing friends most. So most times when things happen that is really, really shocking and your faith is being tested. Because most times as Christians, when things go wrong, we scream and query, but where is God when this is happening? Where is God? And you know, lots of people who would blatantly tell you in your face, I don't believe in God. And you say, but why? Well, if there was God, there shouldn't be wars in the world, and there shouldn't be this, and there shouldn't be that. He says, times like that, when your faith is being crushed, that's when you need fellowship. Because people you may be chatting with have been through similar things, or they've been through harder things, or they are going through similar things. So you need to share these things with other people. So we need a small group of friends to have faith in God for us and to pull us through such times. We need people that we can chat with and explain what we're experiencing, and they can pull us through. They can help pull you back on track. In a small group, the body of Christ is real and tangible, even when God seems distant. There was a chapter we read where, remember the experience of Job, and we said Job lost everything in one day. And this is what Job desperately needed during his suffering time. He cried out. Because Job, when he lost everything, he needed people to help him, to pull him through, to chat with him, to talk him through, to hold him. And he didn't get any of that. So a despairing man should have the belief of his friends, even though he forsakes the fear of the Almighty. So when you're in that kind of scenario, you cannot, at this stage, you cannot relate to God, but you can relate to man. And man at this stage is what you need to help hold you together. In real fellowship, people experience mercy. Fellowship is a place of grace where mistakes aren't rubbed in, but rubbed out. So you notice when things have happened. Let's say it was a mistake of yours and something has really drastically gone wrong. You're in fellowship. People will not come and rub it in and say, oh yeah, it's your fault, you did that, you should have. No, they pull you out. They say these things happen. Don't kill yourself over it. Don't stress yourself over it. You overcome this. It's only a phase. That's what real fellowship is. Fellowship happens when mercy wins over justice. We all need mercy because we all stumble and fall and require help getting back on track. So as human, it's only normal that these things happen to us. That there are times when we fall and there are times when we stumble. It's just part of being human. And that's where fellowship is needed. Where people will help to pull you back on track. Where people will help to mend that broken heart. We need to offer mercy to each other and be willing to receive it from each other. So times like this, you give mercy and be willing to receive it as well. God says when people sin, you should forgive and comfort them so they won't give up in despair. And people really do give up in despair when things happen. But fellowship helps to restore us. You can't have fellowship without forgiveness. So fellowship helps to bring forgiveness into your life. God wants, never hold grudges. That's a big one. Because we do hold grudges as humans. We do. Because bitterness and resentment always destroys fellowship. So the minute you start holding grudges against people, especially people that you're close to, you find that bitterness and that grudge holding, it destroys everything. Because we're imperfect Human beings were imperfect. We're just imperfect, sinful people. We inevitably hurt each other when we're together for a long enough time. So most times as humans, when we're together as friends, we tend to do that. We hurt each other without knowing because we are together for a long time. And that's because we're imperfect people. Sometimes we hurt each other intentionally and sometimes unintentionally. That's just the way it is. But we shouldn't hold grudges. Either way, it takes massive amounts of mercy and grace to create and maintain fellowship. So whichever way it is, it takes a lot from us to forgive each other and maintain peace and mercy. Bible says you must make allowance for each other's faults and forgive the person who offends you. Each other's faults. Forgive the person who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Very important. God's mercy to us is the motivation for showing mercy to others. So again, for waking up every morning, for having the food on your table, for having the clothes to wear, for having that air in your breath, it is an opportunity for you to understand that God is merciful. And if He can be that merciful to us, we should learn to be merciful to others too. Remember, we will never be asked to forgive someone else more than God has already forgiven us. So, God forgave us because He gave His Son on the cross for us. Wherever you are hurt by someone, you have a choice to make. Will I use my energy and emotion for retaliation or for resolution? So whenever someone hurts you, two things you have to ask yourself. Do I want to retaliate? Or do I want to resolve this? And he's asking you, would you use your energy? Because whichever way, whatever decision you take, there is energy involved. So would you rather use your energy to create retaliation? I'm going to deal with this person, and I'm going to show this person how strong and amazing I am, and I'm going to make this person realize that he's never going to try it on again. Or are you going to say, oh, I can't deal with this. You know what? It's all rubbish. Let me just let it go. You let it go. And seriously, I tell you, it's the same emotion, and I tell you, it's even more emotional in the part of retaliation than even in the part of resolution. And a good example, I am on social media, and I get all these negative comments when it suits people. You throw out a video, your dream is to empower people, share your knowledge with people, and there are people who come there not to look at the skill or the knowledge you shared. All they're interested in is picking out ridiculous things. Oh, look at your finger, it doesn't look good enough. Oh, look at your hair, it's horrible. Oh, look at your face, you can't even speak with good accent. You're putting on an accent. And I look at all this and I just laugh. Because you are not in my mind. You know, in one of the chapters, it says, God forgive them because they don't know what they do. That's what I said to myself. God forgive them because they know. You don't know my intentions for coming here. You don't know why I'm here. And so, what is the point fighting you? What am I going to get out of fighting back? So, usually I just write a beautiful message. I said, thank you so much for your lovely comment. And it's become so funny, my kids just laugh at it. That's just the way it is. So when you have things like this, people hurt you, you have that choice. Do I want to retaliate or do I want to resolve? And so many people are reluctant to show mercy because they don't understand the difference between trust and forgiveness. Lots of us. And that's what's causing all the trouble in the world. And I tell you, taking on this program has really helped me in so many ways as well. Because you see, what you're going to find is, which is something interesting I found out, when you buy a microwave, or you buy a car, or you buy a stereo, whatever you buy a mobile phone, there's always instructional manual in there. The manufacturer puts a manual. This is how you use this book, this product. This is how you use it. You turn this one on and then you put that one off. You know, so they instruct you, they guide you. When we are created and put on this earth, there is no instructional manual. I'm a mother, and I tell you, my first child, I had no clue what to do. And the you know, when you're back home, like when I was back home in Nigeria, I know when mothers have kids, there's always family around them. And people are fussing around this new mother and they're guiding the mother. This is how you hold the baby. This is how you rub the baby cream. This is how you give baby a bath and all of that. And I'm here in England and I had no family. And I was dropped in the middle of it. That's you. That's your baby. As you're leaving the hospital, they hand over your baby to you and go home. And that's why most mothers, especially here in the West, they fall into depression. Because no one's there to support you. And you are, you know, baby is crying all night and you are crying with the baby. You have no idea what to do. Baby has a temperature. You, my, oh my goodness, my baby has temperature. And so you just deal with it. And that's the world for you. That's the world we live in. So when we now have this time right now, in this time and age where internet is the thing, and every child right now, children are going through a lot. So when I heard the news, a six-year-old is phoning in to say he's lonely and depressed. Now that tells you something. We need programs like this to remind us what life is about. Because I had to stop everything when I realized things were not going the way I was hoping. You find, you think life is easy. That's why people are going crazy on the streets. Because you have no clue what to do. Mothers are lost, fathers are lost, children are lost, everybody's lost. And we think, we generally think, I used to think, that it was all about making money. That's not what it is. Because you may have all the money in the world and you're still extremely sad and unhappy. And I needed them to understand that. That's why I took on this program. So, it is good that you try and understand who you are. Very important. So fellowship, going to church and being part of a group that hears you out when things are down, because things will be down at some stage. No matter how much you try to guard it and make sure nothing happens the way you were not expecting, the minute they go out of the way you're expecting, you will have to deal with it. And that's why I created time to deal with this. Because from now onwards going forward, I tell you, I have been so relaxed. I'm sure people who know me will be like, wow, I've been extremely relaxed. I'm not worried anymore. In the past, I'll be, oh my goodness, how many students are going to call in and take up training? How many people are going to come and get their hair done? How many people are going to buy my clothes? How many people want to take, you know, you're worried about it. I'm not worried because I know God is there taking care of things and he's got it all written out. Anyway, so many people are reluctant to show mercy because they don't understand the difference between trust and forgiveness. Forgiveness is letting go of the past. Letting go. Trust has to do with the future behavior. So forgiveness, somebody's hurt you, you don't hold it in. You say, okay, it's happened, I cannot change that past, it's gone. Boom. But trust, how do I know if I should put myself in a scenario where this happens again? So trust is about dealing with the future, and forgiveness is about dealing with the past. And trust must be rebuilt over time. It says forgiveness must be immediate, whether or not a person asks for it. Just let it go. It has to be immediate. But trust has to be rebuilt over time. And trust requires a track record. So if someone hurts you repeatedly, you are commanded by God to forgive them instantly, but you are not expected to trust them immediately. So we might be dropping off on the live program on Instagram, but we're nearly there. It's only a few more minutes and then it will be over. But again, on Instagram, remember to join us tomorrow because there's always something coming up. So, if someone hurts you repeatedly, you are commanded by God to forgive them instantly. But you are not expected to trust them immediately. And you are not expected to continue allowing them to hurt you. That's trust. They must prove they have changed over time. The best place to restore trust is within the supportive context of a small group. that offers both encouragement and accountability. And that's what fellowship is all about. So before we end, which is really ending today, this chapter was quite long, is question is, what one step can I take today to connect with another believer at a more genuine heart-to-heart level? So that's what fellowship is about. What step can I take to connect with people on a heart-to-heart basis? Remember, we said we don't want pretentious people, we don't want people who are superficial, we don't want people who pretend that all is well in their life. How can I be with people and be genuinely heart-to-heart with them? That's the question. And then the meditation is, share each other's troubles and problems. We should learn to share each other's troubles and problems. And in this way, we obey the law of Christ. This is Galatians chapter 6, verse 2. So thank you so much for being here. We absolutely love you being part of what we do. And please share this message with your friends. We all need it. Trust me, we really all need this. Remember to like it if you really did like it. And remember to subscribe to us. Because this is a 40-day program. This is only day 18. There's so many more coming your way. It's all about helping you create a new mindset to live your life happy and healthy. God bless you eternally.